Hello everyone. Let's get started. Today we want to continue our discussion of generative modeling and the EM algorithm. Just to bring everyone up to speed again. So we've been dealing with the problem of unsupervised learning through the lens of probabilistic modeling, in particular generative modeling. So the idea was that we want to deal with missing data by positing some assumptions on how our data was generated, right? And these assumptions manifest themselves via a probabilistic model with unknown parameters, and now we can try to estimate those parameters even from incomplete data. Okay, and so concretely, we'll work this out in the context of Gaussian mixture models, right? And Gaussian mixture models are basically are closely related to Gaussian-based classifiers, and in fact can be viewed as the marginal distribution over the data that's imposed by a Gaussian-based classifier, right? So our generative model, modeling assumption on the data, is basically that we first draw a class label, and then we draw a sample from the corresponding mixture components, right, in the context of Gaussian mixtures, that's the Gaussian component. And then we forget about the label. And that's how we believe our data was generated, right? That's the modeling assumptions that we posit. Okay? So you can view it as basically modeling the complete data, both the labeled and the unlabeled part, as given by a Gaussian-based classifier. And we just so happen to not be given the labels. Okay, so this is the modeling assumption, and then we can try to do parameter estimation, say via maximum likelihood estimation, right? And we started discussing the hard EM algorithm, which basically does these deterministic assignments of points to class labels, right? And the goal of this, right, was to essentially make use of the fact that we know how to train Gaussian-based classifiers, models for the complete data, very effectively, right? And so the hard EM algorithm was our first algorithm we looked at that basically makes use of this fact, right? By first using a current guess of the model parameters in order to complete the data, to guess the missing labels, and then using those guessed labels to refine our parameter estimates, right? And then we would cycle, right? And we saw some issues with this hard EM algorithm, right? In fact, points might belong to multiple clusters, and forcing this hard assignment can lead to undesired effects. And that led us to the main algorithm that we've discussed here for estimating mixture models, Gaussian mixtures, the soft EM algorithm, right? And that's what's typically referred to as the expectation maximization algorithm, right? And this is basically almost the same as this hard EM algorithm, right? But instead of forcing each data point to guess and make a hard decision on which cluster it wants to belong to, it now essentially reasons about cluster membership probabilities or class responsibilities or cluster responsibilities with respect to these individual clusters. And then the E step basically comprises the calculation of these class responsibilities, these gamma J's, right? So gamma J of X is basically the probability, posterior probability of data point X being assigned the J-th cluster under the current model parameters. And in the M step, we would then refine the parameters. And that's almost the same as in the hard EM algorithm. But instead for example, in calculating the means, only considering the points that have been assigned to the cluster, we would now essentially, in order to compute, say, the new mean for a given cluster J, all data points, but weigh them according to these responsibilities, right? These class membership probabilities. And these give us these update equations here, right? And so we've discussed a bit between sort of the respective benefits of these two variants of the algorithm, right? And we saw, for example, that one of the issues with this hard EM algorithm is that you get these kind of repulsive effects that come out of the fact that you force data points to decide. So what you want to continue in this lecture is to continue a bit more about mixture modeling and its applications in various circumstances, something that we started to discuss last lecture. And then we'll go a bit into the theory of the EM algorithm and try to understand why it's what it does, Okay? Good. So, one thing that we already had discussed last lecture is that we can make use of these mixture components in order to build more complex probabilistic models. Right? So, for example, we discussed how we can use the densities that we would estimate in a Gaussian mixture, for example, to model cluster-specific data likelihoods. Right? So if you were to, for example, do Bayesian classification, instead of looking at the Gaussian naive Bayes classifier, right, or the general Gaussian Bayes classifier, right, we can look at the Gaussian mixture Bayes classifier. Right? And the goal here is that the assumption that each class distribution, so P of X given Y, is just the Gaussian, is too strong of an assumption, typically. Right? And so if we replace this assumption, that's just the Gaussian, by a Gaussian mixture, then suddenly this gets a lot more powerful. Right? You can model a lot more complex densities with multiple modes, etc., in this way. Okay? But it's really just a small change, right? All you do is replace P of X being a Gaussian by P of X being a mixture of Gaussians, right? So P of X given Y is a mixture of Gaussians, right? And now you have one mixture for each class label Y, right? For each Y, you have a different Gaussian mixture model. And you would estimate it, say, from completely labeled data, right? By essentially going through each class Y, only considering the subset of points that have been assigned that class Y, and then estimating a Gaussian mixture model to get P of X given Y, right, for that particular class label. Okay, and so this is basically using exactly the algorithms that we've been discussing here, for example, the EM algorithm. And then once you've estimated these parameters, say using maximum likelihood estimation or regularized maximum likelihood estimation, you can just apply Bayes' rule, right, to get the posterior distribution of Y given X and act accordingly, right, by invoking Bayesian decision theory, right? For example, just classifying according to the most likely class if you care about the 0-1 loss, or do something else, right, if you have, say, asymmetric costs. Okay, so it's very much plug and play. Okay, we also talked about how we can use this density to now detect unusual data points, right? Since we now have a joint distribution over our inputs and the outputs, we can detect whether we've encountered some very unusual data point, right? By essentially looking at its marginal density, right? And then do anomaly detection, right? So this is what we also briefly discussed in the last lecture, right? We've now estimated our distribution. Now that attaches a marginal likelihood which with each data point, x. And now we can do a decision, right, a classification, according to some threshold that we would pick, right? We might tune in order to optimize the area under the curve or one of these metrics that we've discussed on a validation set. Okay, and so this allows us to make pretty deliberate, I mean, pretty detailed assessments, right, about different uncertainties attached with our data, right? So now, you can not just use the model, so for example, if in this case here, Gaussian mixture-based classifier, right? You can use it not only in order to classify, but you can also detect whether you're unsure about the classes, right? Whether you're unsure whether it's, for example, the red or the black class here, right? But you can also detect whether it's unlike any of the data points you've seen, right? Detect anomalies. So it's a pretty rich assessment that one can make with such a model. Okay, so I want to discuss another use case. It also relates to the last project that you're currently working on. And so this is how to use these ideas for semi-supervised learning. It's not the only way to do it, right? So you can use a lot of the machinery that we've taught you throughout this class to tackle this last part of the project, don't worry. But here's a slide about relating to semi-supervised learning. Still have about 2 weeks, right, to finish. So here's the idea, right? So this is something I just want to talk about it a bit, right? Because semi-supervised learning is something very, 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 very useful in principle, right? So it's very often the case that obtaining labeled data is very expensive. An expert has to sit down and manually say label images, right, or other data types, right? But maybe it's very easy to get large amounts of unlabeled data, right? Image classification is a nice example, right? Or medical applications, right? So for example, medical image classification, where maybe there's large amounts of historical archives of different types of medical imaging that have been done, right? But it's expensive to ask an expert to really sit down and carefully label pixel by pixel, say an MRI scan, right? So that's why it's very useful to be able to somehow combine unlabeled data and labeled data in different ways. Okay? And so we've talked about a whole bunch of different approaches already throughout this class, right? So this is sort of not something that first comes up here, but I want to discuss it and revisit it in the context of generative modeling, right? So we've discussed different ideas, right? So for example, you might use unsupervised data in order to discover low-dimensional representations, say using dimension reduction, PCA, kernel PCA, autoencoders, these sort of things, to get a lower-dimensional feature vector and then train that on labeled data, for example, right? These are sort of ideas that we already have discussed and that you can experiment with. I want to discuss it here through this lens of generative modeling because this allows to simultaneously absorb both the labeled and the unlabeled data, right? Instead of doing some sort of two-phase approach, right, where you first would discover features using only the unlabeled data and then you would do something using labeled data. That's the reason why I'm bringing it up here, okay? And so if you, again, think about basically unsupervised learning as a missing data problem, right? So one of the columns was missing, the labeled column. You can think of semi-supervised learning, right, as a variant of this, one where not all the labels are missing, but only some of them, right? But you can still make the same kind of probabilistic assumptions on how your data was generated in order to fill in the gap, right, impute the missing values, right? So here's an example, right? So just to illustrate this idea, so suppose the unlabeled points are given as these green dots here, right? And there's very few labeled examples as the pluses and the circles, right? If you only look at those very few labeled examples, this might not provide you a lot of information, right? But somehow if you also have these unlabeled points, hopefully they tell you something about the structure in the data, right? Now, how might this work? Well, if you take this generative point of view, right, what you're going to do is you're going to basically try to model each class, right, the positive and the negative class, the pluses and the circles, say using a Gaussian, right, or a mixture of Gaussians, and then try to estimate the parameters using, for example, the M algorithm, right? And just want to go through this, how to do it in a simple case of a Gaussian-based classifier that you want to learn in a semi-supervised way. But of course, you can also learn more complex models like Gaussian mixture-based classifiers that you could learn in a semi-supervised way. Okay, all right, so this is the motivation we've discussed. So we've talked about supervised learning, unsupervised learning, and semi-supervised learning is basically, right, trying to combine both large amounts of unlabeled data and typically small amounts of labeled data, right? And it's particularly easy to do in this generative paradigm, generative modeling paradigm. Okay, and so let's just go through this and discuss it in the context of the Gaussian mixtures, right? And this slide is what we had talked about when doing maximum likelihood estimation just for plain unsupervised Gaussian mixture models. Right? And so what he said is, we stated these optimality conditions. I didn't prove them to you, but we stated them on the slide, right? Which basically says that at the maximum likelihood estimate, the optimal parameters mu star, sigma star, and w star satisfy these nonlinearly coupled equations, right? And they're nonlinearly coupled through their responsibilities, right? Through these gamma j's that in turn depend on all these parameters, right? So these are just the optimality conditions, and then those led to the EM algorithm, right? And now, if you think about semi-supervised learning, the corresponding optimality conditions look almost the same, right? And shouldn't be a surprise, right? So the only additional optimistic condition that you get is that these responsibilities must be deterministic for the label points, right? That should be obvious, right? So it's basically just forcing, right? So essentially these gamma j's for some data point xi that happens to be labeled, right, just needs to be one for the class that it's labeled by, right, and so for the S0 elsewhere. Okay, that's really the only change. And from this, one can rederive an EEM algorithm that that deals with this, right? And so here it is, and it's really straightforward. So it's basically the only difference now is that in the E step, the responsibilities for the unlabeled points you get exactly in the same way as you did before by fitting the Gaussian mixture model. But the labeled points, they're just deterministic, right? They're just set to 0, 1, 0, whatever, right, for the class that it's been labeled by. That's really the only change. And then in the M step, the update equations are exactly the same. Right, so this is really basically the same algorithm with the small change, right, that now basically you incorporate the label information. Right? So this is how to do it for semi-supervised training of the Gaussian-based classifier, right? And you can think a little bit about how one might also be able to do this for the Gaussian mixture-based classifier. Right? So that's basically the idea. And this is, in fact, what you get, right? So here, now, this is the solution that is fits, right, to this data set with two Gaussians and these few labeled points, right? And now that pretty nicely separates the two clusters, okay? And so this is also, so one important aspect, so in clustering, one of the issues is that there's always these many symmetries, right? Because the algorithm tries to reason about class labels, but there's no class labels, right? The class labels are arbitrary, right? You can permute these class labels arbitrary, okay? Now, it turns out that if you just have a little bit of label information, just very few labels per cluster, you can break these symmetries. Right? And so here, very quickly, it'll figure out somehow this is the plus component versus this is the circle component. Right? Versus if you just were to fit the Gaussian mixture model to it, maybe you would have discovered the two components, but you wouldn't know which is which. Okay, so there's a lot of benefit, so this is a more general point, right, in clustering, if you actually have at least a bit of an idea what kind of clusters you're looking for. And this generative modeling perspective very easily lets you accommodate this kind of information. Okay, good. So what I want to do next is I want to talk a bit about the EEM algorithm and its computational properties. So we've been seeing sort of what it is, right? We've seen how we can use it to fit Gaussian mixture models. We've seen how we can use Gaussian mixture models in various contexts, right? So they're really worthy to understand a bit more detail. And so now I want to discuss this EEM algorithm a bit more. Okay? And so in particular, we haven't yet said anything about what does it converge to, right? And issues like initialization and these sort of things, right? You've left a whole bunch of blanks with regards to details of this algorithm. Okay? And so, what I want to do here is I want to talk about a bit more of an abstract perspective on the EEM algorithm, which is a reinterpretation of what it does in terms of this notation here. So we have this this Q function here, which is basically an expected complete data log likelihood function. Okay, so what one can show, and we'll do that and make use of this later, is that the E step of the EM algorithm basically calculates an expectation, that's where the E comes from, namely the expected complete data log likelihood. Okay, and this is a function as a function of the model parameters that we would optimize over. So this Q function here takes two arguments. The first one is the parameters that we want to optimize, theta. And the second argument, theta t minus 1, is the current guess, right, at iteration t minus 1 from the previous iteration of what the model parameters are. Okay? And it's defined as a conditional expectation, right? So let me just spell this out, right? So there's an expectation, right? It's basically a sum over, in principle, a lot of different terms, right? So a sum over set 1 through n, the probability of set 1 through n, given whatever's on the right here that we condition on, namely x1 through n and theta t minus 1, of the log joint probability of the observed variables, x1 through n, and set 1 through n. Okay? And so this is here conditioned on theta. Okay, so let me just annotate this. So this here, this is the complete data log likelihood. Right? So this is the log likelihood we would be working with when, say, fitting a Gaussian-based classifier, right? When fitting the model without any missing data. Okay? But since we don't have complete data, we need to hallucinate it, right? We need to impute it. That's the basic idea behind the EM algorithm. And what this Q function basically says here is we are going to look at all possible imputations. Okay, so we look at all possible ways of hallucinating the missing labels, say set 1 through set n, the cluster assignments of all data points, x1 through xn, right? We condition them on the data, x1 through xn, and the previous model parameters. Okay, so this is basically the impute with respect to our previous model parameters, so theta t minus 1, so whatever model parameters we've guessed, we use in order to hallucinate labels. And in every possible way of how we could look at the all possible ways according to which we could have hallucinated the missing labels, we'll look at the resulting log likelihood of that complete data set, the imputed data set. But that likelihood we're going to look at not with respect to the old parameters, theta t minus 1, but the new parameters, theta, that we're going to optimize over. Okay, so there's this asymmetry here, right? So we use the old parameters in order to make things up, and then we evaluate with respect to the parameters we actually optimize over. Okay? And so this is the general strategy behind the EM algorithm, not just for Gaussian mixture models or semi-supervised learning with Gaussian mixture models, as we had discussed here. So in general, the EM algorithm always operates in this kind of framework, okay? That we basically deal with a bunch of random variables, x, which are the observed ones, and z, which are the latent variables, the cluster assignments. Okay, so here in Gaussian mixture models, and that's what you should keep in mind for the next, for what's to come, think of the z's, right, these latent variable set as just being the class assignments, right? For each data point, what is the cluster assignment? But in general, the latent variables could refer to other things as well. So these latent variables could also refer to, for example, missing features, right? So two lectures ago, we started to talk about, for example, right, how you might want to deal with also missing inputs, not just missing labels. Okay, and you can use this perspective here actually to rederive the EM algorithm in a much more general setting. Okay. So this is, we define this function, this Q function. And now what the E step basically does, it sort of calculates everything necessary in order to be able to evaluate this function Q for any given theta, for any given first argument. And we'll see that in the slide. Okay? So it's sort of some sort of preparatory work that allows us to calculate this objective function, this Q function. And then once we're able to evaluate it, to calculate it, we're going to maximize it, to optimize it. And that's what the M step does, right? Just doing maximum likelihood estimation. Okay? So this basically maximizes over all parameters theta this expected complete data log likelihood, this Q function. Okay, so this is a general perspective of the EM algorithm. Okay, so you can rederive the EM algorithm for many different models through this lens. Any questions about the notation here? Okay. Good. So let's see, how does this relate to things we've discussed, so in particular in the context of Gaussian mixtures? So let's do a bit of a calculation. So let's evaluate Q of theta. So by the way, let me simplify notation a little bit. So let's do notation. I'll just use theta tilde to refer to theta t minus 1. So the old parameters are the one with the twiddle on top, the tilde. And then we'll also use, just drop this up in the indices. So I'll write x to refer to x1 through n, and z to refer to z1 through n. Okay? So in other words, right, this is theta tilde. This is x, z, x, theta tilde. Okay. So, Q of theta and theta tilde is, so the expectation of this, right? So let's put here for GMMs, right? So I'll do all of this for GMMs now. This will change maybe slightly if you use other models. Even holds for a bit more general than GMMs, but you'll see. What I really do is here the unsupervised case, where the sets correspond to missing labels. So it's the expectation with respect to set. It's conditional expectation of this quantity. Right, this is complete data log likelihood, right? And now we need to evaluate this somehow. We need to simplify this this somehow. So one thing I want to just mention here, right? If you look at this sum, right? Why is calculating this not necessarily an easy thing to do, right? This sum here, right, is over how many terms? In general, the sum here, right, is over all possible assignments to the for each data point for each cluster, right? So for each data point, you have k possible clusters, right? This is k to the n many assignments. Right? It's the sum over k to the n many terms. Right? So here we certainly have to be careful and simplify things a bit. So we want to do. And for that, let's make use of this independence assumption. Right? Namely that this probability of the entire data is just the product over individual data points. Right? So by IID, it's just the sum over I equals 1 through n of the probability of xi, set I, given theta, conditioned on all the x's, okay? Now what can we do? Well, we can make use of linearity of expectation, right? So we can take out the sum outside of the expectation. So this is the sum of I equals 1 through n of the expectation still for all the sets. There's a log missing here, right? So log probability of xi, comma set I, given theta. And the whole thing here is conditioned on x1 through n through theta. Okay? Now here, what happens now? So this is sum over all possible assignments of set 1 through set n. But this term that we take the expectation over only depends on set I. Right? So it doesn't depend on all the other sets. So that's important, right? And so since the sets are all independent of each other, given a model, essentially, I can take the expectation only with respect to set I. Right? So that's the sum over I equals 1 through n of the expectation only with respect to set I. And what we condition on really only depends on xi once I have theta tilde. Okay? So really the only thing that matters for the ith data point is the input, the ith input, is only xi. Okay, I'm not going to formally prove this, but this should be pretty intuitive why this happens, right? So we only need to condition on the ith data point and take the expectation with respect to the ith hidden label, right? Okay, so now what is this? Well, that's just the sum over I equals 1 through n. So let's spell out that expectation here, right? The sum of j equals 1 through k of the probability that set I equals j given xi and theta times the log of this, right? Log probability of xi set I given theta. Okay? And now, what is this? What is this? Oh, sorry, this is correct. So what is this? Anyone recognize this quantity? So the probability of set I being equal to j, given the old model parameters, that's just the responsibility, right? That's just the gamma j. So this is just gamma j of xi. Okay? And now for GMM, this would be here probability of set I times the Gaussian evaluated at xi with respect to mu j sigma j. Right, so this is just the what this concretely means, right? That's the complete data contribution of the ith data point to the complete data log likelihood. Okay, so what does this mean? What's the significance of this slide? Well, the key idea is that, as he said, what the EM algorithm does is basically doing the preparatory work to calculate this Q function, right? To calculate this objective function, Q, and allowing us to compute it efficiently over all values of theta. And then the maximization step makes use of that in order to maximize over theta, right? So it means that this step, we need to essentially do all the work to calculate this, and that's what we've just shown here, right? So essentially, all the work we need to calculate this is to calculate the gammas, right? These class responsibilities. Okay, so that connects it to back to what we said before, right? When we introduced this, the EM algorithm, right? That's what you said, right? We calculate gamma j of xi. Okay, good. So this is this objective function. And now, so this is what you've just shown, right? So the EM objective function is equivalent to this quantity here, right? Which is basically a sum over I equals 1 to n, and the sum here of these assignments, set I equals 1 to k for the k clusters, of these responsibilities times the log contribution of the ith data point, right? Evaluated at the new model parameters theta. Okay, so it means that the E step is really equivalent to computing these expected sufficient statistics. Okay, and note that if we didn't have the gammas, or if these gammas were just all ones, then this cost function looks like all the cost functions you've seen throughout this class, right? It's just a sum of log likelihoods for some model, right? Looks like what we had in regression, for example, right? So a linear regression or a logistic regression, all these models, right? So basically just the log joint data likelihood is just a sum of the log likelihoods of each individual data point, right? Assuming the data is generated independently. Okay, good. So that's details for the E step. It's basically doing this work, right? And now what we will next do is we'll look correspondingly at the M step. But for that, I'd actually suggest that we just take the break now, and we'll continue that discussion after the break. Okay. Let's continue. So we're looking at a bit of a more abstract perspective on the EM algorithm, and we'll use that in order to study its convergence. And so what you said, as a reminder, right, is that you can view the EM algorithm as in the E step, doing whatever is necessary in order to be able to calculate this Q function here, so the expected complete data log likelihood efficiently. And then in the M step is to use this objective in order to optimize the parameters. Okay, and so what we've just done before the break is to see, to connect this to what we've discussed earlier in the context of Gaussian mixtures. And we've seen that indeed this Q function can be calculated efficiently as long as we have these responsibilities, right? So these gamma z of x are really the key quantities that we need in order to calculate this the EM objective. Okay, so now let's look at the M step. And as you said, in the M step, what we're going to do is we're going to optimize the first argument of this Q function, right? We'll keep the second argument fixed, the old parameters, we'll optimize the first one, Right? And then, of course, in the subsequent iterations, we'll again make use of the new parameters. They'll go on the right side, we optimize on the left. Right? Okay, good. And also, if you look at the cost function, this is what I had mentioned before, right? The cost function is basically almost the same as the cost function that we would be dealing with in the context of the Gaussian-based classifier. And that should be no surprise, right? Because it's basically the same model. The only difference is that we have to do this imputation, right? We have to estimate or hallucinate or infer somehow the missing data. Right, so that means that basically you can view what the algorithm does in each step, right? In each m step, namely solving this problem here of optimizing over theta of this q function. That's almost the same as solving this MLE problem in the context of the Gaussian-based classifier. Right, just you can basically view it as training a Gaussian-based classifier on weighted data. Okay, and so that happens to have a closed form solution, right? So this here is basically, and I'm not going to derive that closed form solution, right? So if you now basically take this q function here, and you work out the, basically just plug in the Gaussian density for p, as we've done down here, right? So if you just really plug in what is p of xi set I, given the model parameters, namely p subset I times the Gaussian density with the corresponding corresponding covariances, right? Then, okay, so here I should also write equals j. And this is really sub j here. Just notice this. Right? So if you plug in this, then basically you can just calculate its derivative, set it to zero, and you get exactly the update equations that the EM algorithm does. Okay, I'm not going to do that here. That's really very straightforward. Right? So essentially to obtain the closed form solutions to this maximum likelihood estimate, calculate the derivative of this q function with respect to theta, set it to zero, and you'll get the corresponding updates. Okay, so that's very straightforward. So the form of this m step is really straightforward. Okay, so once you have this q function, this interpretation, that explains basically why the m step for Gaussian mixtures looks like the way it does. Okay, so it means that now, essentially, up to this point, what we've shown, or at least discussed, is how this a bit more abstract perspective of calculating this q function and maximizing it in each iteration, how this can really be specialized to the soft EM algorithm for Gaussian mixtures that we've discussed already last lecture. So hopefully that's clear now. What we haven't said yet is what does this algorithm actually accomplish, right? Does it find the globally optimal solution, right? Or what can happen and so on, right? And we already have discussed strong similarities to k-means, right? So if you remember our discussion from last lecture, we've seen that the hard EM algorithm for restricted models, namely spherical covariances and equal weights, is exactly equal to the k-means algorithm, right? So it means that essentially, at least for the hard EM algorithm, we should have exactly the same trouble and the same issues and so on as in k-means. And k-means is non-convex, right? You get stuck in local optima, it's actually NP-hard and so on, right? So you shouldn't really expect any different here. Now, we said there's also this connection with the soft EM algorithm, that was this bit more complicated limiting argument and so on that we didn't really fully go through here. But it's pretty intuitive that similar issues should also be the case for the soft EM algorithm. Okay, and in fact, it's in fact the case, right? So in general, the EM algorithm, and this is what we're going to show, is indeed going to converge, but only to a local optimal. Okay, so what we are going to prove in a couple of slides is basically that it does monotonically increase the log likelihood of the data, right? So it's going to maximize, to really increase log of the log probability of the data given the model parameters monotonically over the iterations. However, there are local optima, right? And if you remember the demo that I've shown you, you already have seen some examples of those, right? Where you actually got different solutions depending on where you initialized, right? So I can actually just pull this up again, right? So this is the setting that we had. For example here, right? So do okay, so now it actually looks like that's probably an optimal solution or a very good one. Right now it looks very different, right? So it clearly ends up in different solutions. And in fact, there will be local optima. And the quality of the solution does depend quite heavily on the initialization. So let's talk about the initialization, right? So now one issue is, so you have the local optima, right? So similar to k-means, what you might want to do is to actually try maybe multiple times with multiple random initializations and look at the best solution you get from all these random initializations. You still have to say how to initialize, right? So we discussed initialization quite a bit in the context of k-means. And there's the strong similarity, right, to fitting Gaussian mixture models and the k-means algorithm, right? So we should be able to somehow make use of what we've discussed in the context of k-means. Right? But of course, fitting Gaussian mixtures is harder in some sense, right? So you not just need to find the means, right? But you also need to find the covariances and also the weights of the clusters. And all of these need to be initialized somehow. Right? And so now we can discuss sort of where do these initial parameters come from. And we can go through each of these cases, right? So the first one is the weights. Okay, and so for the weights, the default, I mean, the standard is to basically just initialize as the uniform distribution, right? Each of the weights would be 1 over k. So that's the default, and that essentially almost always works, unless you really have reasons to believe that you have sort of clusters that are of very different sizes and so on. But typically, just setting the cluster weights to be roughly 1 over k is the standard, and that basically is not so much of an issue. The much bigger issue is are the means and the covariances, right? You have to discuss how to initialize those. And now let's think about the means, right? And so again, we've discussed the connection to k-means, and this is really where this connection is the closest, right? Somehow, if you remember, what we've discussed for k-means is we've discussed random initialization, right, as a sort of a standard approach. But we've actually seen that there's this really nice algorithm called k-means++ that is basically pick data points as initial cluster centers, but pick those non-uniformly. Right? So the issue was that if you have clusters of different sizes, then if you say just pick k data points as our k initial guesses for cluster centers, what might happen is that you only pick points from the biggest cluster, right? And you leave out all the small clusters. And that's exactly the same issue that can arise for when fitting Gaussian mixture models as well. Right? So what you would do is you would basically just use the k-means++ algorithm in order to pick the initial guesses for the means of the Gaussians. So that's the standard initialization that also works very well. And now the last thing we have to initialize somehow is the covariances, right? Of course, k-means doesn't have variances. And so here, the standards, I mean, so one thing that one has to be a bit careful here is that now the scale of the data might matter, right? So k-means is very naturally invariant to just scaling the data by a scalar, right? But for Gaussian mixtures, of course, if you scale the data, you also have to scale the Gaussian components, okay? And so that's why it's standard for Gaussian mixtures in order to initialize the variances basically as the variance of the data. And now what that concretely means, one can argue about, right? So for example, one thing one can do is to just initialize all the covariance matrices just to be the empirical covariance matrix of the data. That's an initialization that makes sense. But of course, that is problematic if you deal with really high dimensions where the covariance matrix, right, is of size d squared, and that can be a big number, right? So in such high dimensional cases, maybe instead of using the full covariance matrix, instead you might want to use the spherical covariance matrix. Right, so basically, just summarize this. So for weights, you would just use the uniform distribution. For the means, we'd either randomly initialize, and again, random initialization can mean multiple things. So it can mean initialize the mean vector as drawn, say, from a Gaussian distribution. But then you have to make sure somehow you cover the domain of your data. So you have to pick a good distribution to sample from. So instead, you might just pick data points as centers, because clearly the data points are where the data is, right? And so a method that often works really well is to just use k-means plus plus to initialize the means, right? So so you would set the ith component as x sub ji, where this is the ith data point picked by k-means plus plus, right? And so the idea again is, right, if you have a data set that sort of is non-homogeneous, right? You have some big clusters and some smaller clusters with fewer points, then k-means plus plus is designed that it has a good chance of picking at least one point per cluster, right? And once you roughly have an idea of where the means are, you typically end up in a good local optimum. Okay? And then for variances, for the covariances, you somehow need to scale, right, according to the scale of the data. And so what you might do is, for example, initialize according to the empirical covariance of the data. So for example, say right, so it's just empirical covariance matrix. Or possibly only the diagonal of this. Yes?
For the initialization of the means.
Yeah?
Does it help if we know something about the labeling of the data?
Yes. So now the question is, can you make use somehow if you have label information, right? So in the semi-supervised setting, you might be able to do better. Any ideas on how you might be able to do better? I mean, so somehow, right? Instead of sampling arbitrary points, you might just sample a point that's been labeled, right? So you restrict, for example, right? So if you fit, right? If you so for example, you might just say I'm going to pick if I have whatever two classes, right? And I want to fit the Gaussian mixture models with two components, right? I would just among all positive examples pick one, and among all negative examples pick one. Well, so this again depends on how you model it, right? So so what you had talked about before, right, is where you just say, I want to train a Gaussian-based classifier, right, that basically just says, I have one Gaussian per class, okay? And here, that means you only have one mean, right? But in this case, I mean, the training, right, in any case would just be, so I mean, in this case, right, you would just pick one point per class. But if you want to select a more complex model, right, then you'd have to say a Gaussian mixture-based classifier, right, then you'd have to pick a Gaussian mixture for each of the components. Yeah?
Would you want to find some way of checking that your labels that you have correlate with what you get from K-means plus plus? So for instance, if you get a good correlation, or you might with your labels, you might have eight labels when they're actually K-means plus plus gives you 10 groups.
Sure.
That those eight groups match very well with the K-means, and then you know you have two missing.
Okay, and so this discussion really here is for the fully unsupervised case, right? In the semi-supervised case, things are a bit different, right? But I think it's a bit hard to really test this assumption, right? Whether the Gaussian mixture-based model is a good model for that for your data set.
So this is referring to the
completely unsupervised case. Yeah. Okay, good. So let's now go on and talk about the convergence proof. So let's actually show convergence, right? So what we want to show is this statement here, right? Basically that the log likelihood of our data of only the observed data, right? The log observed data likelihood keeps monotonically improving over iterations. Okay, and so the way we're going to do this is as follows. So this is the quantity we care about, right? So P of x given theta. So what you're going to do is we're going to use the following trick. So we'll write P of x given theta in terms of also the unlabeled data. So we write it as P of x comma z divided by P of z given x. Okay, so why is that? Well, this is just a factorization of the joint distribution, right? So these are really equal. Okay, so if I multiply with the denominator, I just have here P of z given x times P of x, which is the joint distribution of x and z. Okay, so these are actually equal. Now, the left-hand part does not depend on z. The right-hand part does depend on z. So what we're going to do is we're going to take this equation and take the expectation of both sides with respect to set, the hidden data. Okay, so let's do it. So expectation over set, and we take the log on both sides as well, right? So log of P of x given theta. Again, I'm dropping the subscripts as we had before. It's obviously the conditional likelihood here, right? Given x, and theta tilde is the expectation of the same thing here, right? Of log of P of x comma z given theta divided by P of z given x and theta, right? Note that these are the parameters we optimize over. And the conditional expectation is with respect to the old parameters, as always. Okay, now this here what is this here? So the expectation, that's a bit of a silly expectation. Why is that? Well, the argument is actually not random, right? So there's no expectation, no variable set that appears here. right? So this is just, this does not depend on set. So this is just equal to log p of x given theta, and we want to maximize, right? So this is our objective. Now the right-hand side is more interesting. Now we have the expectation of the log ratio. Log ratio is just the difference of the logs, right? So this here is equal to the difference of two expectations. The first one is this one. And we subtract the expectation that comes from the denominator. Okay. Now, what is this first term? First term is a name. That's our Q function, right? That's the expected Q, expected complete data log likelihood. So this is just Q of theta and theta tilde, okay? And what is this? So this we don't really know. We haven't seen before, okay? So that's the expectation of the conditional log posterior probability, okay? So now we have those differences, and let's see what happens with them. So what we want to show is we want to show that the left-hand side, right, keeps going up as we go through the iterations of the EM algorithm, right, as we replace theta old by theta new, right, theta tilde by theta t. Okay, so that means we have to show that the right-hand side goes up. Right, so we want to show here, that's what we said, right, so this is what we found on the previous slide, right? So log p of x given theta is the q function minus this mysterious other function here, right, that we'll look at. Let's call it f of theta. And we want to show that as we go from theta t minus 1 to theta t, things go up, right? The left, so left-hand side goes up. That means we can show that the right-hand side goes up. So that means it suffices. It's not... it's a sufficient condition, not necessarily a necessary condition. So suffices to show that what holds, so basically Q, we can show that each argument goes up, right? Or the first one goes up, and then what we subtract goes down, right? So basically theta, Q theta of T, comma, is greater than or equal to and f of theta t is less than or equal to f then of theta t minus 1. Everyone agrees? T minus 1. No, there's always 1s. Right, I just compare the previous time step, t minus 1, so the tilde, to whatever is the outcome of the current iteration. I want to show each iteration monotonically improves this marginal likelihood. Right, I want to show here this goes up as I go from theta equals t minus 1 to theta t. Right? So if I replace, so I can look at this quantity here, replacing theta by theta t minus 1, and compare that with replacing this by theta t, right? And I want to show that by increasing it from theta t minus 1 to theta t, things can only go up. What I need to show is to show this term by term, right? So the q should go up and the f should go down, because I look at q minus f, okay? Now, why does the first term go up? Well, I optimize the first argument, right? And among my choices, I have theta t minus 1. Right, so this here trivially satisfies the condition. No, this one. Since q theta t maximizes q of theta t minus 1. Right? So among all my choices, I'm going to pick the best, right? So clearly I must be at least as well as if I had just picked theta t minus 1. Okay, now about this one. Right, so this we need to look at. I need to show that this goes down. This is just in tech what we had just discussed. Okay, so this is the previous slide. So this is what's left to show. Okay, so you want to show that this log posterior probability of the latents can only decrease as I go from theta t minus 1 to theta t, okay? Now, one way to do it is to just subtract the right-hand side from the left and show that the result is bigger than 0. I'll pull both of them in the expectation. Okay, so I'm going to write this as the expectation of z of the log of p of z given x theta tilde, okay, minus log. Let me just, okay, to avoid confusion, let me just put t minus 1 here. Given, there's a lot of those. Let me just, sorry again for this, right? So this here is theta tilde, right? Put tilde. Minus log p of z given x and theta t. Condition on x and theta old. Okay, and now again, this is the difference of two logs. So let's do the opposite of our trick, right? So let's pull to the log of a ratio. So this here is better be bigger than 0. So now we have the log ratio of p of z given x comma theta divided by p of z given x theta t, condition on x theta t. And let me just spell, so this is better, greater than or equal to 0. So let's look at this term here. So what is this? So let me write it out. So this is the sum over z of the probability. Let me, okay, write the following. Let me call this here p old of z times log of p old of z divided by p new of z. So we'll just call p old of z to be the p of z given x and theta tilde, and p new of z is p of z given x and theta t. Okay, these are just two different distributions of our latent set. Okay, and I have this quantity here. I want this to be bigger than 0. Now, has anyone seen this quantity? That has a name, it's a pretty well-known quantity. Just out of curiosity, if anyone has encountered this before. So this here, what it is, it's basically an expression that takes in two distributions over set, p old and p new, and compares them. And it's in fact a well-known distance measure between distributions called the Kolbeck-Leibler divergence, or KL divergence, between the old and the new distribution. Okay, and so this, so I'm not going to formally prove this. So this I'm just going to state as fact that this is always greater than or equal to 0. So the KL divergence between any two distributions, P1 and P2, is always greater than or equal to 0. And in fact, it's 0, at least for densities, if and only if the distributions are actually identical. Okay? If and only if p old equals p new. Okay? So once the distributions don't change, this KL divergence is in fact zero. Okay, but it's in any case, it's always greater than or equal to zero. Okay, that means we are done. Okay, so I'm not going to state this here, right? So this is a fact you can look up. But this is basically the reason. Okay, so this means that the soft EM algorithm, right, is indeed guaranteed to monotonically increase the marginal, sorry, log marginal likelihood, log likelihood of our observed. Now, one more thing one has to worry about here, right? So this just shows it goes up, but in fact, it could go up arbitrarily, right? It could go up without bounds. And in fact, if you remember from last week, right, we discussed that in principle, you can construct these degenerate cases, right, where this can actually go up without bounds, right? It can actually diverge, okay? And so it means you actually have to constrain it. Okay, so for example, you have to constrain the covariances to be bounded away from zero. Right? You can't have the Gaussians become arbitrarily narrow. But this doesn't change things here. Right? All of the arguments go through, even if you constrain the variances. I can redo all the analysis if you put a prior on the covariances, like what we've done last lecture. Okay, and then the objective is, in fact, upper bounded, and this means it must converge. Right? In general, probably only to a local optimum, but it will converge. Okay, so how about the hard EM algorithm? So it turns out the hard EM is something similar. And so it can also basically view this operating somehow on this complete data log likelihood. But instead of taking expectations, it maximizes out the latent variables. Right, that's the big difference, right? So it maximizes instead of summing out the latent variables. Okay, so it can basically show that the hard EM algorithm alternatingly optimizes over the latent variable set. So for given x and theta, it optimizes over set. And then in the m step, for a given x and set, it optimizes over theta. But there's a single objective, namely p, x, z, and theta, right? Depending on these three arguments, and it just keeps alternating between optimizing the two unknowns, z and theta. So it's doing coordinate ascent with respect to these two blocks of variables. Okay, and so that also, now here in this case, this also ensures that this complete data log likelihood monotonically improves. But this does not mean that the log data likelihood does monotonically improve, right? So this does not mean that p of x comma theta t minus 1 is less than or equal to p of x theta t, right? In fact, will not hold, okay? So if you look at the probability attaches only on the observeds, that probably can actually go down, right? And what you see it is basically, suppose you initialize even at the global optimum with respect to the likelihood of the data, so just p of x given theta, and you take a step with the hard EM algorithm, it might move away. You can construct these examples, right? Because it really optimizes a different objective. So the soft EM algorithm actually optimizes the objective, right, that you might say care about if you want to do density estimation, namely log of p of x given theta. Whereas the hard EM algorithm optimizes a different objective, namely this p of x comma set. So it not just cares about the x, but also the set. In applications where you might care about this, right? So care about this joint probability, maybe that's the right thing to do. But if you just want to do density estimation, it's the wrong objective. Right? That explains what's theoretically wrong with the algorithm. Okay, and now, so what I said, basically, this derivation that we did today, this is really much more general, right? It doesn't just work for Gaussian mixtures, right? And also, even for Gaussian mixtures, doesn't just work if you have, say, unlabeled labels, right? You can use it to analyze the semi-supervised case that you've discussed. You can use it to analyze missing features, right? Where you might have different missing features per each data point, and so on. Okay? So essentially, this perspective of looking at this Q function, right, this expected complete data log likelihood, is the right quantity to study if you want to extend the EM algorithm to other settings. Right, and you can make use of this not just for missing feature imputation, but also handling other likelihoods, right, beyond Gaussians. Right, so we talked, for example, in discussing the Gaussian-based classifier, we said, well, what if you have some categorical data, right, not just Gaussian data? So what you might do is you might have additional factors, right, that model categorical features, for example, right? You can easily incorporate it into the model and rederive the algorithm for that case. Okay. So the last thing I want to discuss briefly is, so what about neural nets? So we've discussed generative models, right, that they can be very useful because they actually say something about the complete data, right, not just the labels. But they're also a bit more challenging, right, because you not just have to model, say, a distribution of the label conditional on the input, but you have to model a full joint distribution of the data. And that can be a lot, I mean, quite a bit more complicated. I've shown you very simple examples here, like Gaussian mixtures. But in general, this can be a very hard hard problem. It can be very worthwhile, but can also be very challenging. Okay, and so in particular, if you want to model things like images or audio, right, or high-dimensional data types, then trying to model it with a Gaussian mixture is maybe not going to cut it. Okay? And so now the question is, right, can you use more complex models like neural nets in order to model distributions over over high-dimensional data, like images or audio and so on? And there's a lot of recent interest in the machine learning community on that. Basically, use generative models, meet deep learning, right, basically combined with neural nets. And the key idea is basically to give up on probabilities, okay? So, well, not give up on probabilities, actually to use probabilistic models, but to give up on being able to calculate probabilities. Okay, so here's what I mean. So what these models do is they basically try to capture a complicated distribution, like distribution over images, probabilistically. So we want to basically have a model, P of X, where X is an image, without actually having to write down P of X, right? Parameterizing it sort of with, say, with a neural net. So what is the fundamental challenge here? So the issue is that if you want to write down a model that normalizes, you have to calculate the normalization constants. That means you have to calculate an integral, you have to integrate over all possible images. And if you want to deal with distributions that are not like Gaussians, that's super difficult. Okay? So the idea is to give up on calculating P of X, but rather deal with distributions that you can only sample from. Okay, so you work essentially with the distribution as a sampling oracle. Okay, so as a random experiment, say coin flip. You want to sort of learn to flip a coin, right? Learn to draw an image. And the way this is done is as follows. What you do is you posit a distribution that's guaranteed to be easy to sample from. And so here's how one can do this. So let's say I can draw a sample from a Gaussian. That's really easy. Okay? So I can model, right, the normal distribution, I can draw a sample from the normal distribution. Right, so I have some simple randomness, so let's call it noise, that you can sample from. And now what I'm going to do is I'm going to take that sample and twist it, transform it non-linearly, right, using some flexible function like a neural net, to end up in some complicated object like an image. Another question is, so for any given function I can consider, any given neural net, this is giving me a different distribution. And I can sample from it very easily. I can always draw samples. But it's super hard to compute P of x. Because I don't know which of my samples ended up at that image that I've seen. So it means you cannot calculate P of x. It means you can't do maximum likelihood estimation. That means you have to look at alternative training criteria. And that's where there's a lot of interest these days. And so one approach that gained quite some prominence, not the only one, but one that is very appealing, is called generative adversarial networks. It basically works as follows. It's basically this idea. So what you're going to do is we're going to sample simple randomness, like from a Gaussian. We twist it through a neural net. And that neural net is called the generator. So that generator is sort of trying to generate images, digits, faces. Okay. And now the question is, what is our training signal? So we can't do maximum likelihood estimation. Right? We can't calculate what's the probability of an image. So we need something else. So what's that something else? So the something else that's used here is a separate neural net called the discriminator that tries to tell whether the image that you've made up was actually a sample from the data or was a sample that you drew. Okay, so now you have two models that compete. So the generator that tries to generate images and the discriminator that tries to tell whether you made up that image or whether it's really part of the data. And if the generator can generate images that are very difficult for a discriminator to discriminate, then you did a good job in generating images, right? If you can produce random images that are very difficult for a discriminator to tell from your data, then you generated pretty realistic examples. That's the idea behind it. Okay? Now, the key idea is that, well, there are lots of powerful models for discrimination, namely classifiers. Right? You can use the neural net for classifying. Right? You can use a discriminative model, like neural nets, to basically train a generative model. That's the idea. Okay? And so this is set up basically as a game where you maximize over the parameters of a generator. Sorry, minimize and it competes with parameters of a discriminator, theta d. And what's the objective? Well, the discriminator tries to say, so the function d, whether a given example that's drawn from the data is actually drawn from the data, or whether it was fake. Okay, so this would be sort of standard maximum likelihood estimation. But now you have this term here from the generator. So basically, you do expectation over the randomness that you can sample from the noise of log 1 minus d, of what the generator produced when given random signal z and parameters g, and this is d. Okay, so what is this? So this is basically the probability that the discriminator d is basically a neural net, say, that outputs the probability that x, a candidate image, is part of the original data set. Okay? So the discriminator basically tries to maximize its ability to tell whether the example was really drawn from the data. At the same time, the generator tries to produce realistically looking images that are difficult for the discriminator to discriminate from the real data. Okay? And now that gives you an objective you can calculate just by drawing samples from the model and actually optimize using gradient-based methods. And these models work pretty well. So this is sort of from 2 years ago, some images that were generated from, again, from a generative adversarial network. And sort of from far, so trained on a bunch of animal images or images of dogs. And so from far, sort of they capture a lot of sort of natural image statistics, right, of how dogs might look like, but they capture, so don't fail to capture global coherence and so on. Okay, so this is sort of two years ago. So here's some more recent examples. So these faces were generated from such a network. Okay, and so this is again that's trained on a collection of celebrity face images. It's published at iClear this year. And these are completely synthetic. Okay, these are random samples from such a model. Okay, so it's a generative model. It's not trained using maximum likelihood estimation, right? But using alternative training criteria. But otherwise, it's about generative modeling, right? And about all the sort of techniques that we've discussed here in the class. Okay. So at this point, I've actually covered the content that I wanted to go through in this class. So I just want to quickly wrap up. So we basically covered a lot of ground in this class. We just skip this here. Right, so we discussed a lot about supervised learning, unsupervised learning, etc. But I hope it really was not just a collection of different topics. Right, so over the lectures, I've built up these diagrams. Right, and so each of the nodes is a different method. But what's even more important are the links, right? The edges, the edge types. Right, how you can go, how these are connected. Right, how there's a few basic underlying principles that span the family of methods, right, that are really widely used and practiced in machine learning these days. Okay, so we started with this risk minimization in supervised learning. Then we talked about how we can view unsupervised learning as sort of an analog of supervised learning, also through this lens of risk minimization via compression. Right? And we saw some connections here. Right, between k-means, PCA, least squares regression, and so on. And then we talked about that you can endow these risk minimization approaches, at least most of them, this probabilistic hat, right? You can model them probabilistically somehow. And that can be very powerful, not just for learning, but also for making decisions based on what you learned. Okay? And so we started doing this from the discriminative fashion, just modeling P of y given x, right, but what we ended up and spent the last couple lectures on was this generative modeling perspective, right, where you actually try to model not just distributions of the labels given inputs, but joint distributions, right, over the quantities that you do care about. Okay, and so that's basically how the different methods that we've been discussing here in this course are related. There's really some key concepts that permeate throughout this lecture, right? How to trade goodness of fit and model complexity, right? Or it's important to separate modeling from the algorithm used to fit a model, right? The use of regularizers, right? How to do parameter model selection via cross-validation, the kernel trick, right? How you can view neural nets as basically taking a linear method and parameterizing the features somehow non-linearly. Right, this probabilistic perspective, how we can view likelihoods, right, losses as likelihoods, right, and regularizers as priors, right, and how that gives you flexibility to exchange these components with each other, right? You talk about these different paradigms, right, the discriminative versus generative models, right, and how they're related in many cases, right? And we discussed unsupervised learning through this lens of latent variable modeling. Right, this clustering is some sort of unsupervised analog of classification, dimension reduction as unsupervised analog of regression. Okay, and so we built up this chart here, right? So the last axis we added now was basically this here, right? That now we think about discriminative versus generative modeling, right? And these span different approaches, right? That's really sort of the entire course that we went through here on one slide, right? And it's really important to understand these different axes, right? And hopefully I got conveyed a bit of the idea that these techniques are really connected, right? And they're very modular, right? Very very much sort of plug and play, right? And so fit together in a way that you can easily derive new methods from existing ones and not just apply basic techniques. Okay, so of course we couldn't cover everything in this introductory course. And so there's a whole bunch of courses you can take here in our master's program, right? A successor machine learning course in the fall, a course fully focused on deep learning, a course focused on probabilistic machine learning and decision making under uncertainty, probabilistic AI, more theoretically focused courses like statistical learning theory. And then, of course, if you're interested in research, right, you can take a look at the recent proceedings of the conferences in this area, like ICML, NIPS, and others. And if you want to get some hands-on research experience in the area, there's always opportunities for bachelor's and master's thesis semester projects. Okay, so with that, I'll end the course here, and so you'll have the remaining 1.5 weeks to really fully focus on the project. Okay, hope you have fun at that. Thanks.